For most of human history, Pluto was nothing more than a faint point of light at the edge of the solar system, and astronomers could only guess what it looked like. And then, beyond Pluto, there was an entire frontier we hadn't even begun to explore, including a tiny world we now call Arrokoth. The idea that we would one day have real images of these places seemed impossible. But that changed. For the first time in history, we have close-up images of Pluto and Arrokoth, images that reveal entire landscapes, mountains of ice, glaciers, frozen plains, and colors more vivid than anyone imagined. And what they reveal is nothing short of breathtaking. Planetary science had explored the inner solar system and the gas giants, but Pluto was the last unexplored world of its kind. If we wanted to complete the story of our solar system, we had to go there. The challenge? Distance and speed. A spacecraft would need to travel over 3 billion miles, fast enough to reach Pluto in under a decade, yet precise enough to hit a target smaller than a planet after nearly 10 years in flight. Engineers designed a craft about the size of a grand piano, packed with cameras, spectrometers, and instruments, and powered by a small nuclear generator. In January 2006, New Horizons launched and left Earth at a record speed, faster than any spacecraft in history. The journey wasn't a straight line. After a quick visit to Jupiter in 2007 for a gravity assist, New Horizons spent most of its time asleep, in hibernation mode, to conserve energy. And then, in the summer of 2015, it happened. After nearly a decade of travel, everything came down to a single day in July. In the final 90 days of approach, the blurry smudge of Pluto slowly transformed into a real world. With each passing week, more details emerged. In the last 24 hours before the flyby, the color images stunned even the experts. Pluto was alive, geologically active, complex, and beautiful in ways no one had dared to imagine. At its heart, quite literally, was a vast bright feature that captured the world's imagination. A gigantic, heart-shaped region spanning nearly 1,000 miles across the dwarf planet's equator. This area was soon named Tombaugh Regio, in honor of Clyde Tombaugh, Pluto's discoverer. The left lobe of the heart, called Sputnik Planitia, is a massive plain of nitrogen ice stretching more than 600 miles across. At first glance, it seems smooth and featureless, but closer inspection revealed something extraordinary. An intricate pattern of polygonal cells, some as wide as 30 miles. These aren't cracks or impact scars, they're convection cells, evidence of an active process reshaping Pluto's surface even now. Heat from Pluto's interior, faint but persistent, causes the nitrogen ice to slowly churn like boiling water, with warmer material rising in the center of each cell, and cooler ice sinking at the edges. The mere existence of Sputnik Planitia challenges everything scientists once thought about such distant worlds. At Pluto's frigid temperatures, averaging around negative 375 degrees Fahrenheit, negative 225 degrees Celsius, one would expect geological processes to grind to a halt. Yet here was proof of motion, proof of energy. Beneath this icy plain, models suggest a layer of liquid nitrogen, or perhaps even an ocean of water mixed with ammonia, a hidden reservoir that has kept Pluto geologically alive for billions of years. The plane itself may have formed when a massive impact blasted a basin early in Pluto's history, later filled by nitrogen ice from the thin atmosphere above. To the west and south of Sputnik Planitia rise towering mountains of solid water ice, some reaching heights of 11,000 feet, comparable to the Rocky Mountains on Earth. Water, at these temperatures, is as hard as granite, so these mountains are likely ancient fragments of Pluto's crust, pushed upward by tectonic or cryovolcanic forces. Among the most striking peaks is the feature known as Hilary Montes, alongside Tenzing Montes, named for the first climbers to summit Mount Everest. Their presence suggests that Pluto's outer shell is not uniform. Instead, it's fractured and buoyant, capable of sustaining massive blocks of ice that float atop a softer layer of nitrogen ice or a subsurface ocean. Beyond the mountains lie vast networks of canyons and troughs, some stretching for hundreds of miles. In the region called Virgil Fossae, channels appear to cut across ancient terrain, hinting at episodes of cryovolcanism. volcanic activity driven not by molten rock, but by slushy mixtures of water, ammonia, and other volatiles erupting from the depths. Elsewhere, glacial flows snake away from the edges of Sputnik Planitia, creeping into adjacent valleys just as glaciers do on Earth. These features speak to a world that has not been dormant for billions of years, but one that continues to evolve, driven by internal heat and complex chemistry. The surprises didn't end at the surface. New horizons revealed that Pluto has a delicate, layered atmosphere, extending hundreds of miles into space. In silhouette, during the spacecraft's departure, the atmosphere appeared as a luminous halo, glowing against the blackness of space, a deep blue color that no one anticipated. That blue comes from sunlight scattering off tiny haze particles formed when ultraviolet radiation from the sun breaks apart methane in Pluto's atmosphere. These fragments recombine into more complex molecules called tholins, which gradually settle onto the surface, giving Pluto its reddish-brown tones. The haze isn't uniform. It's stratified into at least 20 distinct layers, each shaped by temperature gradients and winds we barely understand. This thin atmosphere, mostly nitrogen with traces of methane and carbon monoxide, behaves in ways that are still puzzling scientists. Unlike the stable atmospheres of larger planets, Pluto's is transient. As Pluto moves along its 248-year orbit, its distance from the Sun changes dramatically, causing the surface to alternately warm and cool by small amounts that nonetheless have enormous consequences. When closer to the Sun, ices on the surface sublimate into gas, thickening the atmosphere. As Pluto recedes into the darkness, the gases freeze out and collapse back onto the surface in a cycle that spans centuries. Some researchers predict that within the next 100 years, Pluto's atmosphere may completely freeze out, leaving a barren, airless world, until the cycle begins again. The interaction between this atmosphere and the surface creates active weather on a dwarf planet billions of miles away. Nitrogen frosts form on mountaintops, while methane snows may blanket certain regions in seasonal layers. These frosts can migrate over time, subtly altering Pluto's appearance on scales we can observe from Earth. Even now, scientists are studying images for signs of dunes and wind streaks, patterns that suggest Pluto has breezes strong enough to shape the landscape, despite its near-vacuum environment. Color data from New Horizons added another dimension to Pluto's complexity. Far from the dull gray many expected, Pluto's surface is a patchwork of whites, browns, and striking reds. The bright regions, like Sputnik Planitia, consist of nitrogen, carbon monoxide, and methane ices, while the darker zones, such as the equatorial belt, known as Cthulhu Macula, are coated with complex organic molecules formed by sunlight-driven chemistry. These tholins not only tint the landscape, but also provide a glimpse into the chemistry that may have occurred on the early Earth. What astonished planetary scientists most was the sheer diversity packed into a world only about 1,475 miles across, barely 18% the diameter of Earth. In that small space, Pluto hosts towering mountains, deep canyons, glacial plains, and atmospheric phenomena that rival those of planets thousands of times its mass. Every new detail raised fresh questions. How does a world this small retain enough heat to power such activity? Could its subsurface ocean persist today? And what does this mean for the potential habitability of icy worlds throughout the galaxy? Even the small details were captivating. Some images revealed pits on the surface, likely formed by the slow sublimation of nitrogen ice, a process so gradual it unfolds over millions of years. Other regions show dark streaks aligned in patterns that hint at wind-driven transport of particles. The surface is young in places, geologically speaking. Certain terrains show almost no impact craters, suggesting they were resurfaced within the last 10 million years, an eye blink in cosmic terms. Pluto is not alone in its journey through the Kuiper Belt. Orbiting alongside it is a family of 5 moons, each with its own story to tell. At the center of this system is Charon, Pluto's largest moon, and in many ways, its most fascinating companion. Charon is so big relative to Pluto that the two worlds form a kind of binary system, orbiting a common center of gravity that lies outside Pluto's surface. With a diameter of about 750 miles, roughly half that of Pluto, Charon is the largest moon in the Kuiper Belt, and New Horizons revealed it in spectacular detail. One of Charon's most striking features is its reddish polar cap, an unexpected splash of color on an otherwise gray, icy surface. This cap, informally nicknamed Mordor Macula, likely formed from methane gas escaping Pluto's atmosphere. As the gas drifted toward Charon's frigid poles, it froze onto the surface and was chemically transformed by ultraviolet light from the sun into complex organic molecules known as tholins. The result is a dark red stain, a vivid reminder that even in the distant Kuiper belt, chemistry never sleeps. But the surprises didn't stop with color. Stretching across Charon's face is a vast canyon system, a colossal scar running for more than 1,000 miles, four times longer and twice as deep as the Grand Canyon on Earth. This feature, called Serenity Chasma, tells a dramatic story of global upheaval. At some point in Charon's past, its icy crust cracked open, likely due to internal expansion. As its subsurface water froze, it expanded, forcing the surface to rupture on a planetary scale. These fractures expose a history of tectonic stress, suggesting that Charon was once warm enough inside to harbor a liquid ocean, an astonishing possibility for a moon orbiting so far from the sun. New Horizons also detected clues that cryovolcanism, volcanic activity driven by ice rather than rock, may have shaped parts of Charon's surface. Smooth plains in certain regions appear to be resurfaced by material that oozed up from below, perhaps ammonia-rich water or other antifreeze compounds that remained liquid long after Charon formed. If true, this means Charon was not just geologically active in its early history. It may have been one of the most dynamic small worlds in the outer solar system. Orbiting farther out from Pluto and Charon are four tiny satellites, Styx, Nix, Kerberos, and Hydra. These moons are irregularly shaped, tumbling unpredictably through space rather than spinning neatly like our moon. Nix, for example, is about 30 miles long and has a reflective, icy surface with a reddish patch that hints at a splash of Pluto's atmospheric material. Hydra is slightly larger, around 35 miles across, with a surface bright enough to suggest relatively pure water ice. Kerberos and Styx are smaller still, dark and difficult to study in detail, but they too fit this pattern of irregular fragments, likely remnants from the same giant collision that formed Charon billions of years ago. After the historic flyby of Pluto in July 2015, New Horizons didn't slow down. It couldn't. The spacecraft was moving at over 32,000 miles per hour, hurtling deeper into the Kuiper Belt, but its mission was far from over. For the first time in history, a spacecraft had the opportunity to explore one of the untouched building blocks of the solar system, a small, ancient world that had remained largely unchanged for over 4 billion years. That target would come to be known as Arrokoth. Why was this next step so important? Pluto had already surprised scientists by being geologically active, but it's still a relatively large body that evolved over time. To truly understand how planets formed, researchers needed to study something smaller and more pristine, a fragment from the solar system's earliest days. Objects like Arrokoth are called cold classical Kuiper Belt objects, meaning they have stayed in nearly the same orbit since the beginning, never disturbed by the gravitational chaos of the giant planets. In other words, Arrokoth is a time capsule, a frozen relic from an era long before Earth even existed. After Pluto, New Horizons performed a series of engine burns to fine-tune its course toward this distant world. The journey would take another 3.5 years, covering almost 1 billion miles beyond Pluto's orbit. By the time of the encounter, the spacecraft would be 4 billion miles from the sun, so far away that signals from Earth would take over 6 hours to arrive. Unlike Pluto, which had decades of speculation and public recognition, this next target was almost unknown, and that made the mission even more exciting. We were venturing into territory where no spacecraft had gone before. On January 1st, 2019, while much of the world celebrated the new year, New Horizons made history again. It zipped past Arrokoth at more than 32,000 miles per hour, gathering the first close-up images of a primordial world. What those images revealed would astonish scientists and challenge theories of planetary formation. When the first images of Arrokoth appeared on Earth, they defied expectations. Instead of a simple lumpy rock, New Horizons revealed a world shaped like a snowman, a contact binary, two distinct lobes fused together into one body. The larger lobe, nicknamed Ultima, is about 14 miles across, while the smaller Thule measures roughly 9 miles. They're joined by a narrow neck, suggesting they didn't collide in a catastrophic crash, but instead merged slowly and gently, at speeds of just a few meters per second. This discovery alone transformed our understanding of how planetesimals, the building blocks of planets, formed in the early solar system. Unlike Pluto, which is geologically diverse, Arrokoth's surface is subdued, almost serene. New Horizons' high-resolution images showed remarkably few craters, meaning it has been largely unchanged for over 4 billion years. This near-pristine state makes Arrokoth one of the best-preserved relics from the solar system's birth. Its surface isn't perfectly smooth, though. Subtle ridges, pits, and bright spots hint at complex processes during its formation, but there's no sign of tectonics or internal activity. At these temperatures, approaching 40 Kelvin, negative 388 degrees Fahrenheit, Arrokoth has remained frozen in time, a silent witness to the earliest chapters of planetary evolution. Color data revealed something else. Arrokoth has a reddish hue, similar to many other Kuiper Belt objects. This color comes from organic compounds called tholins, formed when ultraviolet sunlight and cosmic rays interact with methane and other simple molecules on its surface. Over billions of years, these reactions have created complex hydrocarbons, giving Arrokoth its rich tone. Its reflectivity, or albedo, is low, darker than Pluto's bright nitrogen planes, yet it stands out as one of the most intriguing small bodies ever studied. What truly sets Arrokoth apart, however, is what it tells us about the birth of planets. Before this encounter, many scientists believed that planetesimals formed through violent collisions, smashing together at high speeds. But the gentle union of Arrokoth's two lobes argues for a different process, accretion in a collapsing cloud of material, where fragments drifted together slowly within a local region of the solar nebula. This supports a model known as pebble cloud collapse, where objects formed in place rather than migrating from elsewhere. Arrokoth is physical evidence that the early solar system wasn't entirely chaotic. In some regions, it was surprisingly calm. Every detail New Horizons captured, its shape, color, surface features, strengthens the idea that bodies like Arrokoth are primordial, assembled during the first few million years after the sun ignited. Unlike Pluto, which underwent internal changes and surface reshaping, Arrokoth remains almost exactly as it was 4.5 billion years ago. Holding on to this knowledge is like having a fossil from the dawn of time, a frozen blueprint of how planets begin. The discoveries from New Horizons shattered old assumptions. Pluto, once thought to be a frozen dead world, is geologically alive, home to glaciers, mountains, and a dynamic atmosphere. Arrokoth, with its gentle, dual-lobed form, rewrote our understanding of how planets begin, proving that the earliest building blocks came together in calm, orderly fashion rather than violent chaos. These findings revealed that the Kuiper Belt is not a graveyard of inert rocks, but a frontier rich with complexity, chemistry, and clues to our cosmic origins. And this is only the beginning. Future missions are being imagined, Pluto orbiters, probes to other Kuiper Belt objects, and maybe one day, spacecraft that push beyond even Arrokoth. Each step takes us closer to answering the deepest questions about where we came from and what else might be out there.